Hi, I'm Evelyn Roeloffs, and I'm a geophysicist with the U.S. Geological Survey. Living here in the Portland area, we need to be aware that we are exposed to earthquake hazards. Compared to California or even Western Washington State, we don't feel earthquakes in Oregon nearly as often. That can give us a false sense of security. Damaging earthquakes can and have happened right around Portland, and we are not far enough from the coast to escape severe shaking from a Cascadia subduction zone earthquake. Three types of earthquakes can affect Portland: giant subduction zone earthquakes along the coast, possibly as large as magnitude 9, crustal earthquakes that are unlikely to exceed magnitude 7 but would be much closer to us and relatively shallow, and deep intraplate earthquakes about magnitude 6.5 that could occur directly under Portland but are more than 22 miles deep. The terms crustal, intraplate, and subduction refer to our geologic setting where two tectonic plates are moving toward each other: the crust of the North American plate on which we live and the oceanic Juan de Fuca plate. The oceanic plate is sinking beneath the North American plate in a process called subduction. All three types of earthquakes occur on faults, large fractures that are the weakest places in the Earth's crust. Slow movement of the Earth's tectonic plates continuously builds up stress on faults. Eventually, a fault will give way and slip, attempting to relieve tens to thousands of years of stress in seconds or minutes. Earthquake magnitude depends on the area of fault that slips and how far it slips. For large earthquakes, these dimensions can now be measured directly using very precise processing of GPS data, though magnitudes have been determined from seismograms since 1935, and that's still how smaller earthquakes are measured. When it comes to estimating the amount of damage an earthquake can cause, it's crucial to be aware that the strength of shaking depends not just on the magnitude, but also on how close the earthquake is. Though a fault looks like a line on a map, an earthquake radiates seismic waves that shake broad areas extending tens of miles away from the fault. The shaking may be amplified in certain places by the local geology, and damage is strongly influenced by ground failure, triggering of landslides, as well as liquefaction. Liquefaction is a phenomenon unique to earthquakes. It occurs in water-saturated soils like those along riverbanks, which temporarily lose strength while being shaken. While liquefied, soil can't support buildings and may flow down even very gentle slopes, ripping long structures like pipelines apart. Taking all these factors together, the damage pattern from an earthquake can be complex. However, by combining computer simulations of the distribution of shaking with geologic maps of liquefaction and landslide-prone areas, we can now foresee the conditions that a building or other structure will need to withstand in an earthquake. The largest magnitude earthquakes we need to prepare for are in the Cascadia subduction zone, which runs from Cape Mendocino in Northern California to Vancouver Island in British Columbia. It's 680 miles long. The deep seafloor off Oregon and Washington is the Juan de Fuca oceanic plate, which grows by about an inch and a half each year as molten rock wells up along the Juan de Fuca Ridge. The growing plate is pushed east and gradually cools. About 70 miles offshore from Oregon, the seafloor bends slightly down to form a trench, then continues sinking downward and eastward under a deep pile of sediments, under the continental shelf, and finally under the North American continent. Subduction zones like Cascadia produce the world's largest magnitude earthquakes because there is a strip more or less parallel to the coast where the ocean plate is not warm enough to slide smoothly under the continent. The locked zone. In Cascadia, the western edge of the locked zone is believed to be just landward of the seafloor trench, but we aren't sure how far east it extends under the continent. It's possible that the locked zone extends as much as 7 or 8 miles inland from the coast. Even though that's 50 miles from Portland, it's close enough that seismic shaking from a great Cascadia subduction earthquake will be very damaging here. How do we know that great earthquakes can happen in the Cascadia subduction zone? Geologists have found evidence that coastal marshes and forests throughout the length of Cascadia were submerged abruptly or covered with layers of sand like those that tsunamis leave, not once, but at least 8 times in the past 5,000 years. In southern Oregon and northern California, additional geologic evidence indicates that large earthquakes occurred more frequently there without rupturing further north along Washington or British Columbia. A Cascadia earthquake that ruptures along all 680 miles of the locked zone would be a magnitude 9 earthquake, as big as the one that devastated northeast Japan in March 2011. An earthquake limited to northern California and southern Oregon would be smaller, but still magnitude 8 to 8.6, still a great earthquake. The most recent Cascadia subduction earthquake occurred on January 26, 1700. It generated a tsunami that crossed the Pacific Ocean to damage coastal towns in Japan, where written records date back hundreds of years. Magnitude 9 Cascadia earthquakes have happened every 400 to 600 years on average, but magnitude 8 to 8.6 earthquakes rupturing only the southern part of the subduction zone have happened more frequently. But it's crucial to appreciate that the time periods between earthquakes are irregular, so it's impossible to know exactly when the next Cascadia earthquake will occur. We can't be sure that it won't be tomorrow, and we shouldn't make the mistake of assuming we have decades to prepare. Earthquakes closer to Portland won't be as large as a subduction earthquake, but they also pose significant hazard. The enormous geologic forces caused by the subduction zone stress the western edge of the North American plate and give rise to faults in the Earth's crust very near our urban centers. Long crustal faults run northwest-southeast in and near Portland. Most of these faults are too deep to break or deform the ground surface and have only scattered background seismicity, but they are considered capable of magnitude 7 earthquakes every few hundred years. Closest to us are the Portland Hills Fault, which extends directly beneath downtown Portland, and the East Bank Fault, which runs from Savi Island along the east side of the Willamette River and extends southeast to just past Mount Scott. Washington County has the Oatfield Fault, visible as basalt cliffs in the Tualatin Mountains and northern Willamette Valley. The Mount Angel Fault in the northern Willamette Valley was the likely source of the damaging magnitude 5.6 Scott's Mills Spring Break earthquake in 1993, our most recent damaging crustal earthquake. We may not yet know all of the faults that could cause earthquakes near Portland, so we can't just avoid those fault lines and hope to escape earthquake damage. Experience also shows that the earthquakes we've had in our short history aren't the largest earthquakes we should plan for. Compared to a magnitude 9, a magnitude 6.5 earthquake may sound small, but if it happens right under Portland, it will be dangerous and expensive. We can learn from an example in Christchurch, New Zealand, where a magnitude 6.3 earthquake in February 2011 killed 185 people and reduced much of their central business district to rubble. The same size earthquake at a similar distance from Portland is entirely possible. On the other hand, even though the fault is 50 miles from Portland, a magnitude 9 Cascadia earthquake will be powerful enough to damage all of Oregon west of the Cascades. It's true that the strong shaking from a great subduction earthquake will last much longer than that from a smaller, closer earthquake, intensifying damage as structures go through repeated cycles of shaking. The third type of earthquake we may experience in Portland is a deep intraplate earthquake in the subducting oceanic plate. The 2001 Nisqually earthquake that damaged the Puget Sound area is a very recent example of an intraplate earthquake. In Portland's history, we've never had a damaging intraplate earthquake, but they are nevertheless considered possible here. Intraplate earthquakes beneath Portland could reach magnitude 6.5, but compared to a shallower crustal earthquake the same size, would have broader zones of damage. Once we get through the strong shaking of any damaging earthquake, we need to brace ourselves for a continuing high rate of earthquake activity, because earthquakes are almost always followed by more earthquakes, known as aftershocks. These decrease in magnitude and frequency with time, but it's common to have one or more aftershocks that are within a magnitude unit of being as large as the main shock. And a small percentage of the time, the first strong earthquake turns out not to be the largest in the sequence. Aftershocks can go on for weeks to years, and aftershocks of a great subduction earthquake will themselves be large earthquakes. Regardless of the type of earthquake, our biggest threat to life safety comes from buildings and other structures built before building codes took our newly discovered earthquake hazards into account. Collapse of a single high-occupancy building can kill dozens of people and gravely injure many more. It doesn't require a giant subduction earthquake either. In Christchurch's February 2011 magnitude 6.3 earthquake, over half the 185 fatalities came from collapse of just the Canterbury Television Building. Even earthquakes that don't kill or injure people are expensive. The 1993 Scotts Mills earthquake damaged three schools beyond repair and did $30 million of damage overall. The impact on the local or regional economy can be severe and long-lasting, especially if critical infrastructure, water supplies, electricity, roads, communication networks, or pipelines suffer damage. Here in Oregon, building codes accounting for earthquake forces went into effect in the early 1990s, so construction since then is much more likely to withstand earthquake shaking. Our challenge now is to deal with older structures not built to new codes. Recognizing the severity of Portland's earthquake hazard can be sobering, but the reality is that if we prepare personally and if our community invests in safe structures, then we can greatly reduce the impact of these inevitable geologic events.